So I'll just go through some really short background about this organism and then move on to our aims. So I have sensed it just now, Potorilus nonosus, also commonly known as the novice cystite because of the many knobs that it has on its surface. It's actually commonly found in shallow coastal waters in the Indo-West Pacific. It has a very limited distribution in Singapore. It's classified as nationally endangered according to the Singapore Red Data Book, is mostly because of habitat loss. And currently, it's also known as about its local ecology and distribution, which is why we decided to conduct this study. So some brief idea of the studies that have been conducted. Regionally, there has been a study on the biology and ecology in Palau, the population biology in Philippines, and for locally, we currently have only studies on the tracking and pattern rate recognition of this particular cystite. So the rationale for our study is to quantify the age structure, the genetic diversity, and the connectivity of pinodosis populations in Singapore. And hopefully with the data that we collect, we want to provide a framework for managing populations and also provide a scientific baseline for identifying any possible conservation priorities. So the aims would be to determine the population age structure. We decided to use size as our proxy for age because currently there is no known literature on how fast cystite ages. We also want to determine the genetic diversity of the population. We also want to know the genetic connectivity between the populations that we have. Are there any exchange of gametes in the north and in the south? So for the first component, which is the population age structure of pinodosis, we did our study at Chukwu Pandan. So it's actually located just somewhere here. I can't really hold this very well. But on Turumbu Pandan, which is actually part of Sari Reefs. So what we did was we conducted a study between March to October 2013. We made 16 belt transects, 15 meters long, and sampled at intervals of 10 meters with triplicate quadrants. We counted the sea stars and then we used this software called CPC to measure the size. For this, we used this term called RMAX, which is the longest arm length of the sea star, which is measured basically from the mouth of the sea star all the way to the arm tip. So the results for monitoring show that we had an average density of about 16.8 individuals, which is actually slightly lower than what was observed in the Philippines, which is 21.2. And as you can see from the graph, it's actually largely dominated by individuals of RMAX of more than 13 cm. So for this study, we actually termed an RMAX more than 12 cm to be adults. So the dominant size class are actually adults. So one possible reason for why we keep finding adults could be that juveniles might have different requirements, such as they could be often found on seagrass areas, possibly conferring their coloration, possibly conferring some form of camouflage to them. They could also possibly emerge at night to reduce the chances of predation. And then as they age, they actually gradually move through sandy areas as adults. We did not find any seasonal distribution patterns as the study was only conducted for 7 months, so it's, we wouldn't be able to conclude such a thing. For larval connectivity, we actually used a coupled hydrodynamic agent-based modeling approach. We did it at four sites, so Turumbu Pandan and Pulau Semakau, which are our southern sites, and of course at our northern sites we have Petin Bruno and Pulau Sukudu here. So basically we included these parameters, which is the infection of currents, mortality, some larvae development to the pelagic stage, once the spawning event happens. And then during larval settlement, we incorporate things like habitat suitability to know where the larvae could possibly settle. So what we found was that for our southern sites, which are Turumbu Pandan and Pulau Semakau, we find that there's actually high level connectivity between the seagrass sites. We found that they're actually good source sites because the larvae are actually well transported across southern waters. So we have two diagrams here, the one on the left here, which is actually for Turumbu Pandan, and the one on the right here, which is actually for Pulau Semakau. This is after about 20 hours of modeling. So you can see for Turumbu Pandan, the larvae is actually pretty well distributed across the southern areas. And also for Pulau Semakau, there's actually this really huge slingshot towards the right. So the larvae actually does distribute quite well, and quite far away from the sources and source sites. On the other hand, for our northern sites, which is close to Kudu and Petin Bruno, what we found was that the larvae actually oscillated within the source sites. So that is actually a possibility for self-recruitment. So for the left one, which is actually Pulau Sukudu, which is located somewhere here, the larvae generally stays around the area. And for Petin Bruno, which is somewhere here, it just oscillates around this area compared to the southern sites. So we also found that Tanah Merah, which is actually a site in between the north and the south populations, is actually a pretty good sink site for both of our sources. However, we currently have no records of pinodosis at Tanah Merah, and possibly we probably need to investigate the site conditions to find out as to why that's so. So now I'll hand on the time over to my teammate Yi Jian, who will talk about the genetic component of our study.
Hi, good afternoon everyone. I'm Yi Jian from the Evolutionary Biology Lab. While hydrodynamic modeling is very good in predicting transport of larvae, it doesn't take into account like post-settlement processes, like how well the adults are able to survive and reproduce and complete the whole connectivity story. So we wanted to do a genetic study to complement the hydrodynamic model. So we collected two feed samples from five sites across Singapore, and we sequenced the 710 base pair fragment of the mitochondrial genome. The sizes of the circles are proportionate to the number of individual sequence, and so we only managed to find one individual at Burton Burger, thanks to Ria. And so we found 22 unique genetic groups within the 70 individual same sequence. But what does this mean? So to help you understand better, we do a comparison with a previous study based on the rest of populations in the Coral Triangle here. They basically found 80 plus haplotypes in 306 individuals. So what we did was we randomly subsampled 78 individuals from these 306, and we found about 24 haplotypes. Isn't it pretty impressive that in this small little red dot, we actually have comparable number of haplotypes as the Coral Triangle? So this is a graphical representation of the haplotypes. The 22 haplotypes, each dot represents one genetic haplotype separated by one mutational step. And here's now we look at the distribution of these haplotypes in Singapore. We can see that there are three very common haplotypes, and these 18 small dots represent private haplotypes that are found only at certain sites. So you see a splash of red color across here, which represents Terumbu Pandan. So you can see clearly that Terumbu Pandan has the highest genetic diversity in Singapore. And we can also deduce genetic connectivity from these networks. So in an extreme case where there's no gene flow, imagine no gene flow between populations, one would expect to see clear division of colors between the haplotypes. However, in Singapore's populations, we see a clear mixing of colors, which indicates high gene flow and high connectivity. So, how are Singapore's populations important in the regional context? So, this is the haplotype network representing the haplotypes in the Coral Triangle, and this is where some of Singapore's haplotypes sit. You can see that we have some of the common haplotypes, but we also have some very uniquely Singapore haplotypes that are not found elsewhere in the Coral Triangle. So we can see that Singapore's populations are important to maintain genetic diversity even in a regional context. Okay, so in terms of genetics, conservation should focus on Terumbu Pandan, but we should also not forget the populations in the north. As you can see here, there are some populations that are found at Sukulu only and not in the rest of the Coral Triangle. So I'll just sum up quickly the genetics part. In conclusion, these sea stars are very, very diverse, but there's also another hidden layer of genetic diversity that we can't see with the naked eye. You can see some similar looking individuals with quite a bit of genetic variation. So this high genetic diversity and connectivity is just calling out to us to do more thorough genetic investigation. So in the ideal world, we will sequence the whole genome. But that's not financially possible. So what we want to do is to use what we should do, and we have already gotten some preliminary data for, is to do a subsample of the whole genome using a technique called RadSeq, also using next generation sequencing, which Amrita and Darren have talked about, to look for single nucleotide polymorphisms, which are highlighted in here. So, for example, in this study that we've done so far, in the 710 base pair marker, we found 29 variant sites. Whereas using RadSeq, we can get potentially hundreds to thousands of SNPs that are sampled across the entire genome. Okay, thank you, Yuta.
So, in conclusion, for our monitoring Terumbu Pandan, so we have a large proportion of populations with adults. We did not find any seasonal patterns, and this could likely be due to the juveniles and the adults having slightly different requirements. For our connectivity, we can see that the populations are largely interconnected, as just mentioned by Jia, looking at the genetic component. There's no clear sourcing relationships, and our northern populations could have some evidence of self-recruitment. And given the Terumbu Pandan's distribution of larvae, it's actually, we find that it's a possible good source for larval recruits. And since Hanamera is predicted to be able to receive larvae from all sites from the model,
we feel that further studies need to be done to assess the suitability of the site. So some recommendations that we might have for this study, where can we go from here with all this data that we have? So we find that Tsim Boh Pandan should be considered for an intertidal management or conservation priority site within the Southern Islands. We find that continuous monitoring of Northeast sea star population should be incorporated into future long-term intertidal monitoring programs with using a very simple thing such as abundance as a possible indicator of population resilience. And given the good transport connectivity that we have in the southern populations, we find that future development plans should take into account the current hydrodynamic regime of the area. I mean, this model seems to be only applied to sea stars at the moment, but there are lots of other organisms that actually use tidal regimes and hydrodynamics to distribute all their larvae around things. Organisms like corals use tides to distribute their larvae. Other organisms such as mangroves actually use all these hydrodynamic regimes to distribute their propagules to other areas. So this model is not only applicable to sea stars and could be used for other organisms as well. So we feel that these development plans would possibly affect these others as well. So we also find that we would like to expand this study at a regional scale to provide a better understanding of sourcing relationships, because currently now we don't know where we are getting our larvae from, we don't know where our larvae is going as well. And we would like to strengthen the preliminary model results that we have with comprehensive parameterization by incorporating things like a better substrate quality assessments, competency of larvae, how long are they viable for? They could be viable for only a few days or weeks, we are not very sure. And if we incorporate all these into the models, we could have a better and more accurate representation of the where our larvae is going. So some potential research directions and applications would be to manage the future populations of pinodoses. Where can we focus our conservation priorities on? And our habitat reconciliation, where can we build suitable habitat for settlement of larvae and in the process create opportunities for nature? And with this, we can find to understand and harness hydrodynamic processes to enhance our many natural areas around Singapore. With this, I'd like to thank the National Parks Board for the funding they have given to us, and of course our own very own DHI biologists who have gone out for all the fieldwork, and the NUS Evolutionary Biology Lab for helping us with the genetics, and of course Mr. Jin Chi Kong for helping us with all this novice stuff. Thanks.